we going?
Sure.
She just wants to talk about Sandy Bay experiment.
Sure. Yeah, I have a library trustees meeting at 6:30. I was here for another reason, and then it got canceled, so I thought, well, I gotta do this too, so I just talked about you. I was gonna send an email, but the Conservation Commission, of which I am the chair, has been discussing over the summer wanting to maybe initiate some kind of collaborative project with the Rec Committee, Parks and Rec, and the Conservation Commission to talk about what we might do with that property to make it more accessible or, you know, usable for some purposes. Right. The only board that technically has authority to decide anything about it is Parks and Rec. So the Recreation Committee and the Conservation Commission would be involved in discussing it, but ultimately it's Parks and Rec that would decide. Mm-hmm. And when we met last week, the Conservation Commission asked if I would reach out to your boards, including the Select Board, and have a member of each of those boards come to our Conservation Commission meeting to kind of initialize this discussion about. A couple of things that we talked about is we have a few really great people on our commission right now who do outdoor experiential education. We have someone who's actually a therapist who does kids, like, hands-on in nature kinds of things. So they have some ideas about that. Mm-hmm. I know there's maybe a sports component. I think it's 6 and change acres. So just having a conversation about that is something that we would like to start. So I can let you know tentatively what we're planning for a meeting date, but is there a particular night that's better for people?
Not a Monday.
Yeah, we didn't set a night because we wanted to just see when your two groups met. So I know obviously when the Select Board meets, but I didn't know when the other groups meet. And if you have a, I kind of follow it online, but it seems like it's not always the same, not like it's not every third Tuesday or something like that.
Yeah,
so
we go back and forth between Tuesdays and Thursdays.
Okay.
But I know for me, especially Wednesdays are not good.
Okay.
I think that Kelly, I might be her now, but I think Thursdays are not good.
Okay.
Tuesdays are always good.
Yes, maybe we try for a Tuesday, and then we did it on a week that wasn't any of your regular meetings.
What are we doing?
She's talking about Sandy Banks for
yeah.
She happened to be here, so she wanted to.
So what I'll do is I will double back with the CONCOM and see what they would like to do is host you at their next meeting.
Sure.
Our next meeting to talk about it. We have a copy of the deed. I'm pretty sure we have a map. And then we could just start talking about it.
Sure, that sounds great.
Okay, so, and, you know, pretty motivated group on the Conservation Commission right now, too. So it'd be, and you guys have all been doing an amazing job. So it might be just kind of nice for all of us to get together and kind of see.
What's the date on that? What did I miss?
We didn't make a date yet.
We did discuss the fact that Tuesday would likely be the optimal night of the five to choose.
Does Tuesday work for you?
Well, not a particular Tuesday.
Not a particular, but in general.
Some Tuesday in October.
Not during soccer season.
Well,
it is about the middle of October.
So here's what I would say. As long as somebody from each group is there, and then we could decide if we want to form some kind of like subcommittee or, or group where we all have a representative on it and we go forward from there. I don't think it's necessary. I mean, I'm happy to welcome anybody who wants to come, but if it's easier to just pick somebody who'd be willing and who's interested in coming, that would be fab.
Yeah, so just let me know. Tuesdays are good for me, and if not, then we'll just compromise and see.
Perfect. Okay, that was all we had.
Thank you so much.
Is she going to come for tomorrow night?
So I'm out of town tomorrow night. Okay. I will try to see if I can get Linda McGivern to come.
And if not, worst case, doing the next one.
Yeah, and worst case, I'll send an email either way
because
I want to get the issue in front of you guys while you're discussing the budget and have it be part of it. But that is also like a CONCOM thing. Mm-hmm. So I'm coming on behalf of the CONCOM to talk about that. So,
okay.
But Linda may be willing to do it. She's been doing a lot of the research around some of the different ways that we could come up with outside sources to fund, to build up some money toward conservation land that we want to try to participate in. So.
Okay. All right, good.
Okay.
All right, yeah.
Yep. Sounds good. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So
good. All right, see you later.
Off to my next meeting.
Sounds like the
thank you for giving me my beverage.
Okay, so where do we start?
Let's, look, since you broached something, let's just finish the conversation with Celia over how to get the CNJ to action, which is to say that they need an invoice which says t-shirt sponsor and, if we're invoicing them to say also movie equipment or movie anything, then are you planning to buy that? And if so, why at this point? Because otherwise, we have to keep those funds and keep it designated for that purpose.
Well, that's what they agreed to. She agreed to a movie purchase on July 3rd. And she wrote me back an email saying that's what she had agreed to, the $1,500 was for.
But you didn't spend any money on movie anything, is that right, though?
Not yet. Right.
So I would say if you're not agreeing to spend money on something movie-related that qualifies under what they are agreeing to give money for, then not to invoice them for that, because it obligates us to hold that money, and who knows how much money, like how much is for t-shirts and how much is for movies, but we have to respect some kind of division, and it implies that we're purchasing movie something, so we ought to do that.
And I was going back and forth with her later on today about that, and when I was putting up the rec meeting minutes from July 18th, we laid out what we were asking CNJ for. And
didn't we ask them for a second thing though? Didn't we tell them that our t-shirt sales were higher and...
Oh, maybe it wasn't...
What, do you remember that?
Yep.
It's t-shirts were like for like 1,000 or something, and then this instead of the 750, didn't we originally say something like that?
It was 1,500 is what they're sending the check for.
Right.
And July 11th, in the minutes we approved last night, we said CNJ, review donation request that was sent and accepted by them. Options for moving forward since the goals have shifted. Accept all the funds as requested and follow through with actions. Accept only the funds for the t-shirts. Ask to change some of the funds from the movie request to the t-shirt request due to the changes in expected totals versus actual totals. The suggestion was made that if CNJ will redirect funds from the movie license to the t-shirt overage, this would be greatly appreciated by us. Equipment, projector, and screen for showing movies would be purchased if it's still allowed by the sponsor. Express to the sponsor and keep the movie license in mind so that we budget going forward and not ask for it to be sponsored, to be a sponsored item in the future.
That was the license.
That was the license.
Well, then it got redirected to the movie projector and screen.
So the $300 was allocated for the movie license, which would go over to the t-shirts. And the t-shirts came in at just under $1,000. So that would jump that from 750 to 1,000.
Well, so that's what the minutes say about how this group feels, but was CNJ on board with that?
That's what I was trying to clarify with Bridget this afternoon. And I wrote to her and I said, because she wrote back to me and said, I...
Basically, you just said,
I
agreed to 1,500.
We agreed to the term.
Just let me know where it was allocated.
She said she agreed to 1,500 on the terms given July 3rd. Mm-hmm. And the terms given July 3rd included 350 for the movie license. We did not contact her to change that until after the July 11th meeting.
So then I think the most you can invoice her for is $1,150 unless you're going, you know, because it doesn't make sense to my mind to buy a movie license at this point.
Not license, but the
you
projector.
Could buy the projector.
Absolutely.
But was that indicated that that's what we're buying and she accepted?
The projector and screen when I...
Yes.
And so I emailed her back this afternoon and I said, for clarification so I can explain to my counterparts, what we're talking about is that the movie license is off the table and that money is being shifted to, or is off the table because it's no longer needed. It's the projector, screen, and t-shirts.
And did she ever respond to that?
I have not been on the computer since like 3 o'clock.
Okay, so why don't we wait and see what she says about that? But if, you know, movie license being on the table, I think we can only invoice her for whatever they're agreeing to support. But if they are agreeing to support a movie projector and screen, then are we at this point buying a movie projector and screen?
Well, the intention is for it to use year to year. So if there's money, if this money is only being able to use for what is intended, the t-shirts were for how much?
$1,000 or so.
We'll have to have an exact amount.
$920?
No, I think they're more than that.
Okay, whatever it is.
We can look up the vendor invoices and find out.
We need to know what the exact amount is, and then the balance of that is what you can use for a movie projector or screen. Because you're, right?
I'll read the thread thoroughly.
Yeah.
And we'll see what she says, but, okay.
Well, that's good. That takes $1,000 down on our deficit.
Looks better. We've already paid for the t-shirts, correct?
Yes.
So that's applying to what we've already paid, so that is a good thing.
Right.
And she said she had responded earlier because she was waiting for...
An invoice.
An invoice for the full amount. And versus...
So it gets sticky with that stuff. Like, you know, because we don't have that money in our pocket per se to spend it, but they won't give us the money until we give them an invoice that we have spent it. Like, what are you supposed to do first?
I would say if you intend to buy it, then you invoice them to get the money and...
And buy it.
And buy it.
Even though, so you just invoice without the purchase?
Well, you do have the purchase on hand, so you're gonna have a PO or a order confirmation. And that's what you can send with it, so it proves that you have it on the order. At least for the t-shirt side of it, so.
I have one invoice for Seco's planning for $920 on here. I didn't see anything else.
Yeah, that's probably what it was then. Because I just copied and pasted it again today. This is the shirt, when I resent it, this is the shirt invoice.
Because you haven't purchased yet the screen and the movie projector, what is your intentions of displaying to her with that information? Because if it was me, I would only pay for the invoice with the t-shirt because that's all you spent.
But that's not what she's doing. She already said that she's...
She agreed to buy it.
But she needs something to see how much it is.
Right, she's putting the $1,500. My understanding is she's putting $1,500 in the mail.
But once you get an invoice, so you have an invoice showing...
No. Well, I think, well, she wants an invoice, but I think the invoice is only a town invoice, not necessarily order confirmations or invoices proving that you've purchased.
But you haven't bought the other two products. So if she wants something that shows what we intend to purchase...
Well, right, that's why I want to read the thread. Like, is it enough that she wants an invoice from us saying we're purchasing these things, this is the cost? Or does she want some kind of order confirmation or verification of cost?
Yeah.
That's not clear.
We were looking for the invoice for our sponsorship total, not the shirts. If you could let me know who to make the check out to, I can send you $1,500. Let's see much else here. From her. Yep, that's really all she said to...
I mean, that's how I took the thread, was like, she's writing on a check for $1,500 and putting it in the mailbox.
My only concern is that we know what the dollar amount is for the t-shirts. If we're not 100% sure what the dollar amount is for the movie projector and the screen, and you don't have enough to buy both or one or whatever, you can't go back to her next year for the remaining of it.
Well, not only that, like, I have a concern about, like, if you can buy it for less money than she's giving us, we're holding on to, you know, $15.48 that has a designated purpose that we can't fulfill.
And what I did when I wrote the grant for her...
You gave her an estimate, right?
Yeah.
So I gave her $50 for the projector and $230 for the portable screen, which I think you actually looked up, right?
Right, and I said to her in one of my emails to her today is, since we're not going ahead with the movie license, we may go with a better quality screen and projector. Is that all right with you? And I was waiting to hear back from her.
My personal feeling is it doesn't matter as long as it's under the $1,500.
Well, it has to stay, but also we can't have more money from CNJ than we've expended for those two designated purchases. So
With my history, you're not going to have that problem, but, you know, because I've bought both of those things before, and they're not cheap.
Well, so, you did you put in this email thread what you're expecting to spend on the screen and the projector?
Mm-hmm. Originally, and that's what Dee was just talking about.
But at this more better quality, it would be helpful to know what the better quality items would cost so we can see how that relates with the t-shirt invoice to the $1,500 total. So that we, you know, because that means it's not going to be exact. Are we holding on to funds we can't expend for that purchase, for that purpose, or are we going to the board for asking for $30 above the donation amount, or whatever it is, to buy the projector?
So at $1,500, we'd have $580 to spend on those two items. So what if we find items that are $550? And there's $30 left over.
Then we have to hold on to $30, which is only to be used for t-shirts or buying something movie related. Mm-hmm. And that's an accounting nightmare.
So you're either going to have $30 extra or you're going to be under $30, because, you know, when you start thinking about getting a better quality one, then it's probably going to be over what you had for your $1,500.
And so it's much simpler to be over.
Yes, I agree. Than to owe something that has
a purpose. Than to hold on to money and try to account for money that has a purpose.
Yeah.
But you need board permission to, you're going to need a purchase order before you buy any of this.
Or we buy 15 more t-shirts.
It depends how much money that is left over, but you could.
So, well, we need board approval, even if, like, the one of the things we quoted was $150. It doesn't meet the $200 threshold. It still needs board approval?
It's a whole package deal.
Okay. Right?
Because we've already gotten the approval and spent out the t-shirt money. And we're just
so you're going to have the projector and it's not going to be under $150 for both of them. Okay. Or you're not buying quality enough.
Well, so a purchase order is only good for one vendor. So if you're buying a screen from one place and a projector from another place, then you need two different purchase orders. And one of them could potentially be under the $200 threshold, but I think it still ought to be a request for disbursement or something mm-hmm. from the board.
Mm-hmm. I agree. Because the check's going to come in here, and a check is going to have to be paid out to either whatever vendor you're going to use.
Right.
So because you can't use the check that's coming in, you're going to have to use the town check to pay for it.
Yeah.
So if you could find prices for the projector and screen that you think you can afford and want to buy within it.
My husband on that research likes those things. Okay. We can have a projector on screen at my house.
I'm reluctant to send an invoice until we know. I mean, yeah, we know we can spend the money. You can buy a really fancy projector for $2,000. Like, we know you can spend the money, but can you spend the money within a threshold that's reasonable that the board would support going $30 over the amount of the donation or something like that? So just to be sure that you're spending all the donation money.
581.
You tell them right to the dollar.
All right.
How big a screen do we want?
I don't want to pick a big one.
We have a 110-inch one in my house.
In your house?
Uh-huh.
That's pretty awesome. You have a wall that can accommodate
uh-huh.
that.
What were you looking for screen size when you did your research?
Do you remember, Sarah?
No, I just did like a pop-up screen, but they have like blow-up screens and stuff like that.
I'm just concerned about a blow-up one just because of storage and stuff, and it can be, because that's
mice.
Like a rubber,
mice.
Not a rubber, mice, it's not, it's like pool material, whatever you call that.
Like nylon or something?
No, it's like rubber, like pool liner. That's kind of what, so I'm kind of concerned about having a blow-up one with the storage that we have, and you know, I'd rather think that you maybe would get something. I have one that's like a nylon threaded, like a belt would be, and then your screen is white, but you have that, and they're on poles.
Support, yeah.
Yeah. So, and I got mine at Amazon.
talking about this also is that you did not put it in your budget for next year for a movie license, correct?
We did, actually. It was included.
Is it under donations or is it under something else?
It's under activity.
And that's the license only for a certain period of time, like 3 months or something like that?
3 months.
And so we had discussed in the past about coordinating with other community groups and getting one for a full year. Mm-hmm. And then you could work with them, work with different groups in town. And the research I've done is it tends to be tied to a location. So if we want to do it at the school, we would have to talk to the school. If we want to do it at the library, we'd have to talk to the library. If we want to have it at the Legion, then we need to talk to the Legion about coordinating with them. It's tied.
So they would require 3 different locations, 3 different licenses, even though you're the same organization? That you could put up. It's not to the organization, it's to the so-called building?
Yes, the physical address. Mm.
That's kind of odd.
It seems really bizarre.
Yeah.
Because you could go to the Legion and somebody can rent the hall and they can watch a movie there, like for an event or something.
And 75 different organizations or families or weddings or whatever that are watching movies, I think that they're trying to avoid.
But I can look into it more. And the blanket license, they don't put out, like the year-long blanket license, they don't put out a quote for. You have to actually contact the companies that give you a license. Like the movie license, they put out information through camp associations. So that, like, if you go to an overnight camp, they have a license for 3 to 6 months so that they can show theirs throughout the summer or whatever. And stuff like that. But the year-long ones, they want to know where you're going to be showing the movies.
So, being that they were located at the grade school, why wouldn't we just have our location at the grade school? And it can happen. Now, if the location is at the grade school, does that mean only the camp can have the use of that license for the grade school? I mean, couldn't PTO do it because it's at the grade school?
So they could.
The same license?
Under our license, yes.
Because it's at the location and not. I mean, why wouldn't you do grade school then and have them each contribute to the license?
Well, if they would, they don't.
Then they can't use it.
Well, right. Well, right, I mean, but they may just not be interested.
And the PTO did look at it last year and decided it was too prohibitive, costly for them to.
Well, probably for the whole year, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's but you know, if you're going to divide it by either the grade school and PTO and us and. You know, it might be definitely more affordable if it's based on location and not organization. Mm-hmm. I imagine we'd have to put the organizations all on there, but the same address is going to be consistent. Yeah. You want to look into that a little more just to make sure that that is what could happen?
It would be good to know what the annual cost.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. Child's having a push. Yes, you fell off the playground.
Oh, jeez.
My husband gave up my phone number, so I'm getting all the messages of that. They're ready for them to lie.
Do we have to verify that that license is based on a location rather than an organization?
That's the thing. I think that's she's going to verify that for sure. Yeah. And if more than one organization could be part of it at the same location, be jointly used. You need to get that verified as well.
All right, so you're gonna work on screen quotes?
Sure.
Definitely do that.
I volunteered him for that.
And I'll look too, because I have them saved on my computer for them. And then
By DM.
Yep.
Does this report that came out today jive with your report?
So that's probably the team.
That one is team. That one's team budget.
Yeah.
So what do you mean by jive? It doesn't include anything. It doesn't include Camp Raleigh. It doesn't include senior.
Okay.
But you should get a senior one too.
I have a senior one.
Yeah, yeah. But we don't have, he doesn't have the Raleigh. You did not get a Raleigh in your email?
I don't believe I did.
I'll get a copy. You can have my other one if you'd like it.
To make copies.
That would be great.
Yeah, yeah.
Why don't you make it?
Is that what we had yesterday? Wait, I have that.
I didn't know I'd have to break down.
Yeah, there was no.
No breakdown.
Okay.
I don't need a copy, Carolyn.
Well, I do. No, I didn't bring it with me.
At least I think I have that here. Maybe I do need a copy.
I might have missed email, but you guys all did.
It was quite a while ago. I don't think it changed. I don't think it recently.
Oh, wait, is this it in here? No, let me see. Yep, that's it.
See, look how organized I am. I don't even know it.
So what else do we need to talk about? Yeah.
Do you, so
was it senior? Did we want to work with senior?
Well, we're kind of going to go back over and make sure everything, because we got updated once.
I could not print that today. My computer was not happy.
I didn't get it, but that's okay.
So.
It's good for Caroline, because she had some things that she wanted to discuss with her, so she could.
My computer doesn't like this. Whatever you.
It was the
sheets, was it Google Sheets?
It was the format from Caroline.
Oh, I hate Google Sheets.
Ooh, I like your copy of the layout.
I wish we didn't have it, but so I tend to use it.
Read the top.
Thank you, ma'am.
I got it.
Thank you very much.
Which budget do we want to
start? Who do we want to start with?
Senior.
Senior budget. Okay.
Are you throwing that at me?
I can.
Do you need to look at that?
Well, that's the income side was changed just to put in the $500 town allotment and to take out the $250 from fees after the discussion last night that we do not want to charge for senior programming at this time. So, and that it was premature to start talking about other funds and sources. So that it was changed to just the $500 town allotment.
Okay. Is that the only thing that's changed since last night?
Okay. On that side. On the expenditure side, I did rework some of the numbers. I dropped publicity, I added flyers, I added the word signage, and I added $50. That line changed from 200 down to 150. I put
not on my copy. It's 200.
Was that yesterday?
No, that's one she printed today. That's one you sent out today.
Oh. Do you have an extra copy?
We can copy this one.
Okay, so, but it has gone down to 150.
Yeah. Okay. And I put $100 in the speaker line.
Do you have that?
Nope. Okay, well, 200.
Maybe let's just get a copy.
Oh.
So
So that's what you printed today, huh?
Yeah.
So, okay, there you go. And these, that's
other side.
So evidently I saved and sent the wrong version.
It's okay. It's okay, we have to use a copy right here.
Well, at least you didn't erase everything. That would have been me.
So does your budget reflect just the $500 allotment on the revenue side?
Yes.
Yeah, where'd you get that?
$500 on the one in the revenue side. Yes, proposed anticipated revenue $500 under town allotment.
Okay.
That's for revenue. And then the budget.
To the expenditure side.
Shows $500.
Yep. That's what we, I evened them out.
So you, just the changes within it.
Yeah.
Did you sub it or did you just add, plug it in? I mean, when you add your columns, is this a sum or did you just override it? No, it's a sum?
It's a sum.
Oh, okay.
I made sure that.
So it just is in other areas?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, what? Because it's 2, 4, 5. Okay, so if that's, yeah. So 2, 4, 5, but if that's 1, 2, some other ones have changed.
Yeah. So my question would be, do you want to take this or my, right now, we, for this year, I put $100 into the paper products line. Figuring that'll carry us partway through to 2020, because we probably will not go through all of the supplies at this point. And I was thinking maybe that we should reduce the mailing costs or office supply line and distribute that to lower.
Okay, I'm gonna let Caroline have a comment. So she is not showing any anticipation of revenue from outside sources. How is that going to affect us? She's showing it only as a town allotment, so a town supporting this 100%. So she's not seeing any fee collections, she's not seeing any donations of goods or services or any of those. Should we be putting it in there? Because if she can't accept it if we don't, right?
So it's prudent to put donations. You know, you can put grants if you really think you're going to apply for grants. You don't need to break it into lots of different revenue categories, but I think it's a good idea to have some kind of donation slash fees. Like, it can even be the same line. Mm-hmm.
So we have a donation of goods and services line. Mm-hmm. So should I put something in there under the income source?
I would just get rid of goods and services and just call it donations slash fees.
Mm-hmm. Because there could be an opportunity where you might charge a minimal fee for someone, for an event that you might be planning, that, you know. So I think that you should at least put something.
It's a good idea, and it doesn't mean that you have to do it, but it is a good idea. You can also just get rid of the food and drink line altogether, and instead of calling office supplies, just call them supplies.
We have it up above as supplies, and I put paper products and stuff in there, so get rid of the food and drink line.
I would just get rid of it, and
I mean,
and supplies and supplies. You can buy, you know, a number, you know, you can buy a lot of different things in a supply line.
Right.
But I was also thinking earlier today, the office supply line. Like, we have a phone number for Camp Raleigh, and that's what we're using for Team Camp to buy a cell phone and stuff like that. It's the contact. How are the seniors going to contact people? Is it going to be contacting the town if they are?
You've got to work that out, but.
I would create some kind of an email address to some kind of a senior for your senior programming. If you're expecting people to reply back to you either by email or phone, you got to give them somebody's, or like I, on
we
my
can,
personal
we,
account, I have Family Day as one of my emails, you know, under my personal account. I mean, it doesn't cost me anything. I just have it so I know all those emails are going to go there.
And we can receive paper mail for you and then hold it for you. But it is going to be interesting to figure out, you know, a lot of elderly people don't use email.
Yeah.
And, you know, mail takes a while. And it's nice to be able to pick up the phone. And it's going to be a problem just like it is for summer camp, that people want to be able to pick up the phone and talk to somebody, and there's not really a contact for that.
But I would not use the team or the rec director's phone, because then who's going to know when that season ends and the season starts, and they're going to be getting calls possibly. You don't want to do that.
Yeah, I agree.
It needs to be, I don't know.
Yeah, I don't have a suggestion
want to give out their
that,
phone but number, but maybe it just needs to be either mail or email.
Use your home phone instead. Nobody answers.
Well, I mean, you could have a lot of phone calls if you give out your own phone number. But I don't think they should use the rec directors.
But, you know, I think it's a great idea to create an email address for the purpose. I just think particularly when you're targeting seniors, you're not going to get your target. You're going to miss a lot of people.
But that's okay, if you get, if we get a few, get a few.
So, that was another thing I had thought about, would be in the office of Lifeline, not just like mailing announcements out, but like, how would they contact us? And that was something I thought about.
You know, the other thing is, if one of you could be the point contact for it, when somebody calls the office, if it's a question that I can't answer, then you can, I can take down a name and phone number and you can block your ID and call from your phone with a blocked ID just to call the person back and respond to their question.
Seems like we've kind of split all that stuff up at this point in time anyway, right? Like, I feel like I'm the point person for Team Camp. You seem to be the point person for Camp Rally. And so there you go, so you're the point person for seniors. We all have our hats.
So, if we combine the food and the supply lines for this year, that would be $200 for this year, 2019, for food and supplies. And then we could, we could drop down the $200 for next year and put some, put like $100 in, or put the, take $150 and put it in the supplies line and just leave $50 for mailings, because we're only going to have a handful of mailings to certain individuals who are on the mailing list. And if something regularly gets set up, then they're going to know when things are scheduled.
Right, I think that's fine.
Okay. So take office supplies down to $50 and put $150 in the 2019 supply line to cover food and stuff. 2020.
You said you're going to go from 200 to 150 now?
And that one's gone down to 50.
To 50?
Yes, because we're only going to have a couple of mailings to do.
But this is going to be your food, drink, and office supplies.
I'll flip it over. Food's going in this one.
And supplies?
Yep.
Okay, so what's that going to be?
150.
Because right now you have nothing.
Right.
So you've got to put the 150 here.
Yep.
Okay. And you're going to make this 50.
And that keeps us at our $500 amount.
Okay.
And so if we put, Caroline, we were just talking about, if we put money into the grants, or into the donations and fee collection lines, then that needs to come out here too, right? To make them even?
Yes. It's just one of those lines that would get colored. So. Yes, and it's a conversation point when you present your budget. It's implied that you're not. So, if you put $2,000 in grant funding, you it's not really appropriate to put $2,000 in grant, in, like what are you putting as an expense? Is that for programming? Is that for, you know, a venue? Is that what is that for? You need to be more specific in the expenses. But then it's also implied that you're not spending that expense unless you're getting the grant. It's also true, and this is a little bit of a finer point, that you're raising the taxes for that $2,000 grant expenditure regardless of whether you get the money. And then, you know, it all works out in the wash. I don't mean to split hairs over it, because if you don't spend the money, you don't get the grant money. In the end, it works out over a year with reporting with the state. But, you know, you're raising the $2,000 to spend it, regardless of whether you get the revenue. But the justification is that you're getting the revenue and that's what's going to ultimately make it neutral on the tax base. But you're going to raise the money through taxes, and then you're going to hopefully pay for it with the revenue. But if the revenue doesn't come, it's okay because you didn't spend the money. But it takes a while for that to get worked out. It's not big dollars, but
no.
You know, it's still something to think about because it's going to raise your budget by whatever percentage.
Well, this particular request is raising and appropriating $500 with no revenue source at this point. That's what this
right.
is doing.
But, you know, I want to be careful with grant funding because you can, you know, $1,500 is a significant amount of money. Don't be planning that if you don't have, like, what's your plan? Like, if you're going to budget to receive grant money, what do you think you're receiving grant money for, and what's the expense with that, and is it really going to happen? Like, you know, what's the plan?
So, I had in there last night $250 for fee collection. And so it's not an astronomical amount, and that's what I would say I would put in for the donation fee collection line, $250. And then we have an activities fees and a venue cost that are two separate lines on the expenditure side. So I would put it into activity fees, and then we also have a third line of presenters, speakers, because the top three things that people wanted were continuing ed, connection with the older and younger people, and I forgot what the third one was, but it was all in the email I sent out earlier.
So programming is essentially what you want to use grant money for.
Yeah. So.
Okay, so.
But then again, I feel like if somebody comes in and they give a donation for a meal, that we should put it back into a meal. Like,
I think there's a lot more conversation about how you can do this and what you want to do. I think you plug in a number and you move on because you've got a lot of energy to put into Camp Raleigh and even Teen Camp that, you know, I would say put in your $500 or whatever you're going to put it in. If you think you can get a grant for $250, put in a grant for $250. But I think it's not worth the time to fine-tune it. That's just my opinion because, you know, we need to... I just want to make sure you guys are ready for Camp Raleigh and working on that budget and working on that programming for the winter. I think you can fine tune a lot this way or that way. I don't think there's really a right answer about or even a wrong answer about how much you put in grant funding. If you want to put, you know.
I think with the.
I just think it's such a small amount of money. We ought to just like pick a number and move on.
It is a small amount of money. However, there isn't really a plan and written
and
what that money's going to be.
And that's, I guess, my point, is
yeah.
that there's like too much, there's not enough time to
yeah.
create the plan.
Right.
And so what's reasonable given the time frame, because we don't really have time to be talking about what really is the plan, because we need to be spending the time working on, to my mind, Camp Raleigh.
Because you have to, one, convince the Board of Selectmen to take forward, and two, you have to convince the Budget Committee to accept it. So there's two steps to this. So you gotta have a plan of what your intention is, because right now you're asking for $500 that's going to hit taxation. So you have to explain what your plan is.
I think the bigger issue is, and it's, you know, so going from 300 to 500 when you didn't use the 300. So why are you asking for like more money? And I'm not trying to be argumentative. I'm just trying to help you think about the sales pitch, so to speak. You know, You all were very busy running summer camp this year, and you just had your recap meeting now in the middle of September for summer camp. You need to spend the winter writing the programming for, like, writing the procedures and policies and job descriptions. We've got to work on all that stuff this winter for Camp Raleigh. So, you know, as much as I appreciate the idea of senior camp, I think it takes a back burner to what originally invigorated this group, which was getting Camp Raleigh back off the ground after everybody who was doing it for years retired. And
so are you recommending that we don't, should, that we don't do anything with the senior programming this year?
I'm not recommending that you don't do anything with it. I'm recommending that we not spend a lot of time talking about $200 here or there, but that you flatline it to $300 would be my recommendation. If you're going to up it to even $500, I think you've got an uphill sales climb on you. And that's fine if that means the world to you, but I'm suggesting that that's going to come at the expense of getting Camp Raleigh documented enough so that that's on good footing for next summer. That's what I'm ultimately trying to say. You guys are split into three different directions, teen, senior, and even in four with basketball and Raleigh. There are a number of things that didn't go as smoothly as they need to go with Camp Raleigh that we ought to my mind, focus on that and make sure that we get it really well documented so it's on good footing next year.
My thought was is that we'd get through Camp Raleigh and then talk about a senior program. Last night we came up with the idea for coffee hour at the library and getting it started. I can get going on that now that the camp is over, but you're saying there's just a lot of other stuff that we need to be doing.
I think
is that right?
Yeah, what she's saying is that it's great to have senior programming in mind, but because Camp Raleigh was disjointed this year, we need to focus more on that. If I had to decide, Celia, we've got a lot going on. Where do I want you to spend your time? In Camp Raleigh's in dire need, I would put you on Camp Raleigh as opposed to senior programming. So it's one of those managing the priority.
So what really needs to happen, what I think the first step is, with what Camp Raleigh needs, to my mind, and I said this briefly before, is for each of you who had an integral part in its program over the last 12 months, write your job descriptions. Figure out what were your jobs even. There was a hiring manager, there was a grant writer, there was a registrations manager, there was a packet writer. Think about all the jobs that got done. Each of you that did one of those things, write your job description. What does that entail? Really thoroughly, so that somebody else could do it. What's the time frame that each of those parts of that job, in the 12-month calendar, when do those pieces parts have to fall into place for this to happen? Well, you want to have somebody hired by early enough that they're onboarded and trained before camp starts. So to my mind, that's where this group ought to focus now, is on those job descriptions. And then once the job descriptions are all drafted by each of you, you're reviewing each other's so that you understand them and that they're clear. And at the same time, in the context of what didn't go so well this year, so that those things can be identified as somebody's job and added to a job description. And then you all are looking at all the job descriptions on the table, and when you pick one, you're picking everything in that job description as it's now written, which is really comprehensive, and it's a heavier lift than we've previously articulated, which will help you all see that I think you need more members that are willing to really work. But I think you have to define that, otherwise we're going to continue on with these sort of, nebulous job descriptions where I'll do this, but then we forget, or we got busy. You guys are in a funny spot where you're volunteers trying to do a professional program, and you have real lives outside of what's going on with this program. But this program needs to be written to a certain level to make sure that we don't have liability issues. It was killed by the select board 4 years ago over liability concerns. It's not met what the select board at that time had in mind of, with documented process and procedures and forms and
okay,
liability
so
checks.
Here's my question to that. So if the select board has a certain, and I don't mean to throw, you know, throw some work at the select board, but if there's an expectation of this group about liability, then shouldn't that be presented to us? Like, I feel like we're kind of going back and forth with, we need to make up policy and procedure, but the select board is telling us what that can and cannot be.
Well,
so it's yes. Very,
so, so all we know, like, that's a really good point. We don't, we've never had a, like, a really, like, a nuts and bolts bulletproof program. The program was killed because it was a convenient time while people were retiring to say, that might have been a good thing given what we know now about the modern age and what insurance policies say about liability concerns that we should be aware of. All we know is that there's a lot of things we don't know about things that can happen and things that we could get sued for. So when the program was dissolved, it was the statement of the board at that time, which is a different board right. than you have now,
right.
but it was the statement of that board at that time that the program, that you, you know, you all would figure that out, which is not really fair because you're volunteers. It takes, I think, going to other communities to say, what are all your written policies around how this thing operates? And see what applies here or what needs to get translated to something that's appropriate here. But we don't even know, like, you know, we have ideas about swimming pools and it doesn't really occur to us that there's a whole big thing about having, you know, kiddie pools. You know, as things pop up, we check and there are issues with them, but it's only because issues have come up that we've checked that we know there are issues of them. You know, I think we need to evaluate other places and see on paper what they do so that we can compare and that will help inform getting this written. But, you know, you're right, we don't really know where to start with this. I think the job descriptions is a place because you know there are certain functions that have to happen. But even outside of that, there are these other liability concerns, like how do you, you know, can you say that the program is only whatever the program is, and if your kid requires some kind of special assistance medically or educationally or behaviorally above and beyond that, that you have to supply that? Or that we will for an extra charge, or, you know, or you have to tell us. I would hope they tell us, but they don't. So, you know, we don't have any policies about that, and then what does that open up for issues that might happen? And I just think we could learn a lot from other places who have had more bulletproof or bullet-resistant programs for longer.
Well, I know, having talked to Barrington, I mean, we've certainly copied enough of their stuff, but, I mean, we've heard, I mean, just, I mean, I'm sure some of this conversation is coming from yesterday and a couple of issues that we had this summer, but there are places that don't take diabetic kids. So, but is that our place to say we don't take diabetic kids?
Well,
or is
right.
that, who's coming down with the last word?
So,
is really what
well, the select
I'm
board
asking.
Is gonna well, so the select board is gonna have the last word. But I think what you know about REC is that REC is probably never gonna have an on-staff nurse. So if you need on-staff nursing to have type 1 kids, then
I don't know.
Well,
who knows?
Well, so you know, I think. Well, but that's a good point. I think. You know enough about your program and what you're affording in your program that we're probably not going to offer one-on-one attention for people with special needs because that's just not within the budget of, nor is it really the premise of the program to offer that level of service. So what does that mean for who you can and who you can't serve?
I think, I think though that if we have made a decision going forward, or if we haven't, whatever, if we're going to take special needs or not, then we need to have clarification of what we can and cannot do legally, because we don't know that.
Well, and we
so,
don't want to
I
discriminate
mean,
against people, but we have to only provide what we can
we
afford.
We don't have the resources
some, right.
or the experience or the
right.
we don't understand.
Staff.
So who's,
that is that.
So for me, when we were talking about this last night, it became, well, legally, what can we not do? But so now we're like, well, who's the resource? Who helps us determine that?
So we need to either talk to Municipal Association or something to find out what we can do as a organization that offers a program that we are not staffed properly enough to take anyone with a special need. Mm. Because it's not safe, because we don't have the right staff, and we can't afford the right staff either. I mean, if
we
can't
have to have that.
So knowing that, for just for staffing reasons alone, we would, let's just say we agree that no, we're not going to do it. But so again, the question came up last night was, well, if we do agree to do that, can we legally do that?
So I can
ask this. We need to talk to the Municipal Association or somebody else that's going to give us that answer.
Right.
And the answer that's going to be in our book or our rules or whatever will be the legal statement saying what we can and cannot do.
Yeah.
Because I don't know enough about that. All I know is that we don't have the proper staff to handle something like that, or the amount of staff to handle something like that.
I can certainly find that out, but I think it would also be prudent to talk to other local good programs about how they address this issue.
They may not have the same issue as a small town in Rollinsford has. That's the difference. And if people are coming from other cities and towns to come here, that means that they probably can't get it in their own town or
maybe,
city.
Maybe, but it,
so that is telling us that we're getting them.
Well,
because.
So yeah, I don't disagree with that. I think it's just that they must have some kind of language,
possibly
in a policy or in their packet or something that we can crib, because often what happens is we have a determination, you know, that it would be beneficial to do it some sort of this way, but we don't have the language to use. That's good language. If we have good language, then we have people who can vet our language. But it would be helpful to have something that we can edit to make appropriate for here. But, you know, yes, I can certainly find out.
Is so Gary Bannon...
Well, that's what I would say. We should talk to Gary Bannon.
Is he in, is he in charge of Parks and Rec as well in the summer?
Yeah.
I can try to reach out to him and ask him what they have for their for some kind of a policy book or something, and see if he would share that with us. And
I'm sure he would. When I talk, because I went into it, I just popped in his office one day.
Well, if you know, said, and you want to, and you're comfortable in doing it, if you can, if you want, then it doesn't matter. I know him. I not real well.
Yeah.
Do you want to do it, or who's doing it? Who's Gary Bannon?
He's a resident of Rollinsford.
He lives in Rollinsford. He's been the recreation director for Dover for a zillion years.
Yeah.
30 years, maybe. He was the first guy I talked to when we started doing all this.
Yep.
And he sent me the Camp Cool guy. So that's to talk to about their programming there.
He lives on Mountain Rollinsford.
Right. Stuff. That's from Clement.
Yep.
So the donkey.
which one of these going to contact?
It doesn't matter. Yeah.
I'll do that.
I'll do it. All right.
Is there another gold standard town we're supposed to be looking at?
We can also look at Summersworth, because again, we're having, and it could be just fees are lower too than these other two locations, but maybe Summersworth can share it with us. Melanie knows who the person is.
I am Kristen.
I would say, if you're willing to look at another community, it almost doesn't matter what the community is.
I mean, I don't want you to feel
about,
if you want me to do one of
the community our size, would that make a difference?
Yeah. I think that would actually really be helpful to find something.
I'm going to the towns that have the population, and I know what the top 10 are, so I can send those to you. Like, that are around our population?
They don't have to be near us, yeah.
In New Hampshire, at least.
Yeah, it would stay out of Maine, just because they may have different rules and different fundings, too, because of their state.
So I can send that to you.
Okay.
All right.
I'm saying I'll be in Kentucky on Friday.
Okay. Whatever you can do is great.
So I just want to back up. I know that Camp Raleigh and Teen Camp are the big things, but I came on this committee 4 years ago, and I spoke to the board when I wanted to come onto this committee for senior programming. So I'm willing to fight for that.
Nobody's not saying you can't do it. We're just saying there's a whole lot. Let's not nickel and dime it. Put your budget through, and see what you can do. Nobody's saying she can't do it.
I think when
we're just saying it's
resources
turning into a big for a couple hundred bucks, okay?
So my other conflict in my head is that I am only one person of this group, and I need your permission to move forward with that programming. So I have not spent my 2019 budget because we've been so swamped with Camp Raleigh that I have not been able to get the permission to go ahead and start something. I got that permission, last night.
You did.
Is that what everybody else is?
Yes, because you have $300 to spend.
And so right now, we've allocated it, so right, I can start reaching out to the library and getting things printed and spending that money.
So I think the only
for thing what purpose? I'll put it in whatever you're doing. I mean, just I was totally against doing another survey last night.
Yes, okay. And that's
it's
not
got right to be some kind of a program that's going to be coffee. A program that's going to be. And the coffee thing with I thought that was a good idea.
So we're going to start with a coffee hour. I will reach out to the library and the Black Bean, and I will use the supply line to get paper products and snacks for the first one. And there's $100 in there for us to create a sign, because Denise said you probably can't make a sign large enough for the A-frames, but we could use the A-frames from the town to get things out.
It takes multiple pieces of paper, but you can use multiple pieces of paper to print something that fits in the A-frame.
Possibly the school might laminate it for you, so then it keeps it together.
That's why.
You're going to do something.
And so, like, I could put together a flyer, you could copy it here, and I could post it around town, but I was thinking for the A-frame, I could get something at Staples and just slap it on the A-frame, or we can do it on multiple pieces of paper. So that's why there's $100 in the booklet flyer line. So that's why I'm saying.
I think what she was saying about the 500, you have the 300, let's spend the 300 and do the 300 for next year, because we haven't really investigated the use of the first 300.
You haven't spent it, so but that you're asking for 200 more.
It's knowing Raleigh was 5,000 behind and me wanting to ask for more, which is why I changed the budget.
Yeah.
But see, that's what I ran into was like in the we had 300, we spent 400 in the 2018 right budget, so we were over. So I'm asking for 500 to cover our butts, right, because we found out like doing what we did wasn't enough.
Right.
The 300. And yes, I haven't spent
but that was a mailing, so we're not doing a mailing again. So right, that was the expense of that. It just really helps to have a plan. Like, it's really hard to sell a budget to the people if they don't know what they're getting for it. Think of it that way. Like, think of all the public meetings you've ever been to and how divisive those conversations can be. And you're going to raise my taxes by $200 and you don't even know why? Mm-hmm. Like, you know, and again, I'm not saying it that way to be argumentative, but like, come up with a plan. I want to have, you know, coffee monthly. I want to have, you know, movies
donuts and
quarterly. Like, you know, like what's the plan? And I think it's just not, you haven't had the time. You and you all haven't had the time to agree on what's the goal with the funds, that it makes it really a hard sell to the public that you need the extra money, or that's the right amount of extra money. Because, you know, maybe you're really going to need $650 to do whatever it is your plan is. I don't mean to discourage you. I think senior programming is a wonderful idea. We have a lot of seniors, and I think they would love it, and it's a great community thing to do. But what does that mean? What is it going to look like? And how much, whatever it is that it's going to look like, what does that cost?
So I guess what I'm saying is I feel like last night we had a good discussion and we got the ball rolling, but now it's being overshadowed by here comes Camp Raleigh and Teen Camp, and we're asking senior programs to be pushed aside just as the ball gets rolling, and we can't discuss your budget, we can't discuss raising it because we have all of these other issues that are mm-hmm. here. And I'm not sure.
That's not what she said.
But that's what I'm
saying. That's not what she said. What she said is, let's not nickel and dime it.
So
if you want to proceed with the 500, go and proceed with the 500. Have a plan, though, because you have to get it approved by the Budget Committee and the Board of Selectmen. have a plan. If it's coffee, three times this next coming year or whatever, and having a guest speaker come, maybe local people who won't charge you, like someone from the historical, or, you know, coffee with the police chief, or, you know, any of those, put that in writing as a plan. This is what you want to do. We're not saying discard it. We're just saying let's not talk about nickel and diming it.
I think the talk of resources may have scared you a little bit, because now we're talking about if we're going to continue with the amount of people that we have, we're going to be in the same position that we were. So, but if we can get it together and get more committee members and disperse the work like it should be dispersed, like a true business runs,
right,
then we should be able to. So pay attention to senior, which I would like to see happen.
My final question is we approved a budget last night for senior. Mm-hmm. It was edited tonight. Do we need to reapprove it, or do we just move ahead with the budget bottom line of $500?
That's all you really have to do.
Yeah.
You just moved money around. You didn't change the dollar amount that we took forward. You just moved it within the same program. I wouldn't worry about it.
Okay.
Just take it forward.
So
come with a plan, though. This is what I want to do with this money.
Coffee donuts. It's a difficult thing that is not your fault that the annual cycle has worked the way it does. That, you know, you've got the first quarter of the year that, you know, people are burnt out recovering from holidays and otherwise trying to think of programming and having occasional meetings and working on job descriptions. And then the second quarter, we're continuing to work on job descriptions, working on hiring, and the registration packet's ready. And all of this is around getting Raleigh and Teen Camp off the ground. And then you've got the summer, which is the intensive running the program. And so here it is that you haven't had a chance to talk about senior and work on senior, but at the same time, it's time to talk about next year. And it's hard to talk about next year when, you know, yet next year is always in context to the previous year, like Camp Raleigh. Like, you gotta, you know, knowing how that went, let's tweak these things. We're gonna need more money, less money, more money here or over there, and that influences the next year's decision. Senior camp fell out of that cycle because you all were busy with Camp Raleigh, that you, like you said, you haven't had a chance to work on senior things. That's not your fault. It's just an unfortunate symptom of having not a lot of members and a lot of stuff to do.
Because the ideal situation is that you would just be isolated to do senior.
Mm-hmm.
And then other people would be doing teen, and other people would be doing
And there would be enough people
Raleigh.
That
there would
it's
be
all...
enough, but you can concentrate
And it's not
on
all
senior.
On you, and that everybody's right. got the support they need so that all the programming...
But nobody can do it all. That's cool.
It's just a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm. All right, so
I think we need to offer discounts for committee members for the children. That's what I think. I think we would get a lot more committee members.
Yeah, you'd get 200 committee members, and that's a different kind of problem.
We have to have it. First 10, we need 5, whatever it is, but whatever discount, that's what we need to do, but we're not in that spot yet.
All right, do we want to go to team?
Let's just finish the camp.
Okay, so let's go a week.
So we looked at the 20. So did you have anything to discuss with us for the 2020?
Raleigh team.
I know what your concerns are besides like the budget, but is there?
No, I just wanted to say though that I don't know if you read Chuck's email later this afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't get all the sports engine income in there. So you guys are doing better than the $400 that you think you're off by. He thinks it's more like $2,000 that you have of income that's not yet reported. So he's asking for sports engine access so he can, for next year, so that he can add income on the fly. Rather than right now, we're seeing sports engine income as a part of the bank reconciliation process.
Oh,
so this is
okay.
And that's why it's not jiving, and we're behind, and you know.
Well, what I can tell you is that, so I did the same thing today. I went to go tick and tie everything. And so they do give us a total, but the total includes what they collect for service fees.
Yeah.
But if you add up just, so we are, so from what they have, from what they said that they deposited to us, I only see $400 that were off, that they owe, or that they gave to us, but we don't know where it is.
Okay.
But so where he's coming up with the extra, I'd like, I'm curious to find out.
We'll see. It would be helpful to see.
Yeah, but remember, he has to remove rec basketball out of that number that is in that number right now.
Sports
total.
Understood.
Okay.
Well, he can't remove it, but
no,
we all need to remove it.
We have to remove that part of it, yeah.
Right, but this is separate. This is other income from Sports Engine. What would be really helpful is a report. Mm-hmm. Could you email me and Chuck a copy of all of the deposits that Sports Engine says that they...
I have them right here, but do you want to email? Because you're welcome to take this. But do you want to email? I can email it too. I'd be happy to.
I would prefer that if you don't mind.
Yeah.
And then we can reconcile and find out if it's really $400 or if it's something else and where we're different.
You know, whatever. Whatever we can
How much was it to get the upgrade in the Sports Engine?
It was like $59 a month.
For the 6 months that we needed to have it open?
Yeah, you can do it by the month. It's $39 a month, no matter how.
And this is going to supply better reporting, correct?
It's going to give us more, not so much better reporting, because the reporting is a reporting. It's just not good anyways. Mm-hmm. I mean, so the upgrade doesn't pertain to the reporting. It pertains to bells and whistles. So if we wanted an inventory store, if we wanted to use their scheduling or calendaring, chat rooms, communication rooms, you know, instant IMs. We wanted to use that. It didn't have anything to do with reporting, unfortunately.
Does it affect the fees that they collect from people?
No.
Okay.
You mean to make it lower if you go to the next upgrade?
No.
It's still the same. Okay. All right. I thought for some reason it was reporting, which would have been better if we could get, you know.
I think the reporting is good for what other people use it for,
mm-hmm.
but because we've got so much that goes into this,
mm-hmm.
the reporting is just crap.
Okay. So, all right.
It's not a manual.
Yeah.
Crap.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah, I'll get that to
you. So you still don't want to go forward with going with the upgrade and putting it in the budget?
I don't think so.
Okay.
I mean, I'm worried about adding extra money to this budget at all, because I think we need to stabilize some things before we add new issues and problems and things to do.
Now, did we have time to both Teen and Raleigh's directors? Did we add funding to their account so they can be working on some of these requirements that we're looking for, like the job descriptions and...
So you're talking about the 2 or 3 hours a month?
Yeah.
Nope. I didn't do that.
Should we be doing that?
So for Teen, there is a $300 registration line, which would cover some of those fees.
But salary though?
No, it's a registration line to upgrade computer registration in Teen. So there is a $300 expenditure in the 2020 Teen. For upgrade to registration.
I didn't see that.
And then, as to your question about the salary for the teen camp director was not fully expended. She had roughly 500.
She started late.
And we built in a whole extra week for her to do training and stuff, but we think she only worked her 7 or 8 hours a day. She did not do her other duties that were included in her salary line.
Well, nobody had the training, unfortunately. That was a problem because of late hiring and just not time.
So
so I wouldn't take it out.
So you we know. Kept it the same as last year. So it's 7 weeks at
like 20 hours or 25 hours.
And then 1 week at 40 hours, which is 16 hours of training and extra planning time, 3 days of planning time, 24 hours of planning time.
I don't know if you want their help in
Let's see.
In being part of this they should, I mean, they're employees, not volunteers.
We did, but we're ahead by $300, so I left it at $300.
I think the job ahead is immense, and having employees adds somebody who can be accountable, and you know that a certain job description, whatever that is getting done.
So I know that we've talked about ideally that having somebody come in 2 hours a month or 3 hours a month to get going, whether it be February or March going forward. Mm-hmm. That means that we've got to hire early if the other director decides, mm-hmm. or whatever, we make a decision on that. Mm-hmm. But I'm thinking where, I'm so worried about the fact that we've already, I mean,
well,
3 years in a row now, we're behind.
You've got a chicken and egg problem, because the other side of it is, you've got this whole program to write. What if you can't get more members, or you can't get good members? What if you don't get this program written? You know, like, to my mind, it can't operate the way it's been operating. Something's got to change to make it less of a liability.
So if
you hire somebody who's accountable for some kind of essential function, they're accountable to that function. But yes, it comes at a cost. So is it in the rate? It's either in the tuition, or the town is valuing it and subsidizing it to that degree.
It can be a combination of both too. You know, town picking up some of the expense as well as, she did go up in the tuition rate though, that her proposal is to go up in the tuition rate already.
Yeah.
Not that much.
No,
did you go
much.
Up on your tuition rate? Mm-hmm. Okay. I mean, clearly we are below the average because people are coming from other cities and towns to mm-hmm. us. Could be for several reasons, though. That one, that they can't go somewhere for another reason. Mm-hmm. But I think that we do have to be, I think we do have to go up a little higher. But having someone have a job, compensation for it also has some merit, I think, because it's you know,
so
the way being that will get done.
So right, and then the other thing is that this whole task of writing the program and hitting the ground running next year would be a lot smoother with consistency in staff. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't there for, you know, recap. I don't know how you all feel about how staff worked out, and if you want to post it open again, or if you want to hire the same staff. That's a whole separate conversation, but consistency.
We can talk about that, actually.
Consistency would make this easier, though. But I think it's also important that whoever your staff is, that they've, if they don't have a say in what some of this process and policy is, that they're at least hired so far in advance that they have enough time to be onboarded and trained and really understand and ask questions about the program. And so if you don't hire for consistency, then you're hiring, you know, earlier for somebody else, and you've got a higher threshold for training. To my mind, you know, somebody is training themselves essentially by helping to write this program. Mm-hmm. They hit the ground running. But if they're not part of the writing the program, then they have to read everything that got created and be trained. So you're kind of creating more work. You know, there are two different ways to approach this.
So here I see a potential issue, and so help feel this out. So just for, just to understand. Let's say Melanie's coming back next year. Now, we haven't had that conversation, but let's, just for the sake of argument, she's coming back. So if she's coming back in February and she attends two meetings in February, two meetings in March, and helps us do all this stuff, I mean, we have to pay her.
Yes.
So what are we paying her? And what are we paying her with? And
well, that's what I'm saying, that I think needs to be added to the budget.
And we talked earlier this year about not that the salary line was the budgeted for the summer, but maybe putting in a meeting stipend for them to come to the meetings or pre-camp training.
Yeah, it doesn't necessarily have to be their hourly wage that they would have when they have 20 kids under their, you know, but a stipend of
you know, this is for every meeting
it's
that you attend.
It's the off-season rate versus the summer season
right.
rate or something like that.
Because clearly it's not as much responsibility as it is to be.
Right, but you have to entice somebody to want to do it.
Yep, mm-hmm. yes. Yeah, no, you're right, you're right. Mm-hmm. But it's going to be done one way or the other, so we have to try to come up with some funding to help that.
So I need the income to offset it somehow.
Which I think is an increase of rates.
So how do we look at the select board and say, we want the town to fund 10 grand for a rec person? So how does that conversation take place?
Well, I wouldn't go 10 grand because okay. that won't happen. But I'm just saying, because you're increasing your rates to compensate for that, those hours that we're asking for.
So I think the way
based
conversation
on an
goes.
Average of the last 2 years, I would take an average of your last 2 or 3 years of mm-hmm. enrollment and give an average of what, you know, each one would be as an increased rate. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, and that's what I would put in there.
Well, I want to backtrack a little bit. So before we took over, the town put in a good 18 grand towards this program.
School.
Town no, put in that is not.
When did they put the
yes.
town in?
That's part
right?
of the town budget,
it was, right?
It was 18, not like
it was
at least
the school. It was in the school budget for years.
I don't know, and it may have been, but it was part of the
well,
school.
Only because it was a school employee.
Rex
used to be.
It was at least 18, the year
so,
that I came in, it was 18 grand.
I don't know
grand
what
town.
School paid for, mm-hmm. but it was in the budget. It was not revenue neutral. And
no,
to the point of
it was not.
Probably, I don't know, maybe that amount of money. It was in the tens of thousands of dollars.
So how do we go back there?
Slowly, incrementally,
yeah.
I would say.
I'll take a look
so
the
I would say,
and find out.
I would say you build the budget around what you need, and you come up with a dollar amount that you think is fair to ask the town to support it by, $4,000, $6,000, whatever you think is reasonable. Build the budget with spending what you need. If you get what you need from the board, $4,000, $6,000, $20,000, whatever you think you're asking for, you're going to have to make up the difference with rates.
Right.
It's a shared cost mm-hmm. at first, and then over time, in theory, if the program gets written well, it's operating well, and the select board is feeling more comfortable with how it's running, and you've got the enrollment at that tuition rate, then every year is about tweaking it and seeing, like, maybe you can do more, well, I don't want to spread you thin, but, you know, there are other things, you know, the rec committee can do that can potentially.
There's ways to do it. I just have to figure it out.
I don't think that you know, I think that's a worthy argument that it used to be something that the town valued enough to spend money on without offsetting with rates.
Right.
Well, and my point to that, honestly, you know, 18 grand is not to cover the program at this point because we're almost there. But maybe that 18 grand can be for our rec director in Rollinsford so that we can all take a break. Because I'll tell you, if our rates go up much higher, you're pricing me out and I'm all done. Because why am I here if I can't afford a program that I'm creating?
That's a good point. So that's what I worry about too. I worry about pricing people out.
Yes, because I have more kids.
We're cheaper.
That's my problem.
And yes, we're starting to get people from out of town, which is great because they get charged the non-resident rates. But I also worry about pricing us too much out of town. Pricing us too much out of the market. Yeah, again, we're not close to
that,
it.
Yeah.
We're not close to it, but.
Well, so that's the other way to do the math then, is that you figure out what do you think is the max tuition rate. You know, that's another whole conversation. What do you think is the max reasonable, affordable tuition rate for the number of students that you receive? What does that create for income? And then how much does that allow you to spend on a director? And then you're asking the board for the balance, and you're just making a good argument about asking for the balance.
Well, we can ask the board.
So you
can ask the
director,
but what about budget committee?
having one
How are they going to look at that?
Like a Heather
behind.
Yeah.
Like a Heather's.
You have a brand new budget committee.
And that person is in charge, and then they have.
I think you can do it. It's just about, you can explain history, and it's about where you're going.
And the contact for them.
And for basketball.
To my mind, you need this director to get where you're going.
Yes.
Yeah, because with everything that's been happening, including instruction and the manuals and the way we're growing the program, it's really the time on this has outgrown us. I mean, I was saying to Kelly the other day that we both work full-time.
Right.
And because of all the requirements that we now need to have from the town and from other things that are going on, that we have timed ourselves out of this. There's no way we can.
Well, and I'm amazed that you're still sitting at this table after all the blood and sweat of the last 3 years that you all have put into this, and how much I've seen you at these meetings and in my office over all of this stuff. It's intense. I don't think it's sustainable that you all continue to work to this level. I don't think it's fair to ask you all, volunteers, to continue to work to this level, to something that, for something that all these residents just benefit from. And yes, they're paying for it, but they're benefiting from this program that's on volunteer hours. And it doesn't make sense to me, and I don't think it's sustainable. So I think you need to increase your volunteer base, because to my mind, if other parents value it, then they should help support it by volunteering their time. But you can't always rely on that. If you want a program that's going to be here for your grandchildren, then you're going to need a professional that's accountable to the board for policies, who's going to make a certain minimum standard happen every year.
Yeah.
A board or a committee for any organization or for any sub-part of an organization or any department really is supposed to be making, it is a decision-making body. It's not designed to be, nor is it really appropriate for you all to be worker bees. And while that's, you know, what's been put upon you if you want to have a program, it's not sustainable, but it's also not appropriate for all the reasons that we were just talking about, that you all are not, you know, child welfare liability experts. You know, you're not policy people. You're people who have a good heart, who want to make something happen. And so your job, really, ideally, should be values decisions about what kind of a program do we want to have, what do we think is a reasonable price point, who do you want to hire that looks like is the right person to carry out all this mission, and then there are worker bees. But here we are in Rollinsford, where things are small and they don't work always the way they do in bigger places, so we make do. But I don't think, you know, to your point, Kelly, like, why would you do it if, you know, it's so much work, why would you do it if your own family can't benefit from it, if it doesn't work for you? It's not sustainable. So I think if this program's going to last, you need some kind of consistent, sustained professional support. All right, director.
I agree.
So we have to get there with that.
Well, no, they just said they were going to pay for it. Yeah. So
that's what I
know. But I think we need to find out what a part-time one does and how much they make.
Well, what do we need done?
And what do we need done? And, you know, and how many hours a week? And what is the salary on it? And look into that, because I do believe that that is going to help us to go forward, because being burnt out is not a good thing.
Right.
And it is a lot of work for people who have busy schedules already.
And you're at the point where you're not even at status quo of tons of workload, but we're asking you to really bump it up and write this program. So here it is, the end of summer rec, kick back and relax and have a little vacation and cool down, but no.
No,
we're going to like bump it up into high gear and do all this extra more stuff. So
I think, David, that might be a good project for you too, because along with, what I did was I started looking at the towns that have the same sort of population that we do, And I was looking at some of the rec programs. So maybe you can take that a step further and look at, dig into maybe salaries or...
See what information they'll share.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, see if they have a rec director and what is the salary and the required time for that salary.
You know, by interest, I know Deerfield runs a really great rec program, and I think they're a pretty small population. And they've done it right for a while, I think, so.
But this can be for all, you know, it's all year. It can be basketball, it can be team, Raleigh, winter, ice rink, you know, all of those kind of things.
Yeah.
And they can, they would have some time to do looking for grant money and stuff versus, you know.
Yeah.
So are we saying that we're all in agreement about moving forward and looking into the possibility of a part-time rec director?
I think that we need to definitely look into it, and I will take some of that on, just at least to see if I can get some dollars. What, you know, hours and dollars at this point, and see what we can, and share that with you guys.
So what do you want to do as far as the 2020 is concerned?
Well, right now, let's go forward with what you have. And I think if we can, if we have time and we can get it to the board, we should try. But let's, I mean, we have to get going on budgets. So what you guys have, and I mean, we were pretty okay with Raleigh. We didn't really have any questions on Raleigh. So, and you were looking at a raise of $10 for residents and non-residents 20.
Right.
Yeah.
I think there's some tiering opportunities that we could look at too.
Okay.
As we go through.
All right.
That.
So we've she already addressed that in her income. Yeah, I don't think there was anything.
So Carolyn, are you saying that the committee would still be responsible for creating the job for the rec director, and then they would take it off and run with it?
I don't think that's going to happen this year, that you're going to be able to afford somebody that, I don't think you're going to be able to afford enough hours to have somebody write this whole program for you. I think you all still need to write the job descriptions that you fulfilled this last year. I think we need to go down two paths at the same time. Mm-hmm. That you don't have time to wait for, is there going to be a rec director, and then hiring that person. Mm-hmm. I think you still need to go down the boat, like, please now work on your job descriptions.
Just what you, this is what you did, and the requirements, and the same.
And this is where you think about when in the calendar year certain parts of that ought to happen in a best case scenario. Mm-hmm. And then present them to your peers, and you all can see them. So I think that has to happen anyway. You have to proceed with writing the program. And then if you can hire a rec director, there's always more to do. That person can help read through it, make sure it makes sense, see if there are any missing pieces, other policies they think are necessary. They can do more research with other organizations to see what they do. There will be plenty of work for that person to do. But I think, you know, 4 hours a month starting in February or March is not going to help you now. I think you need to still be moving now.
Was there any questions about teen camp that you needed to get through for? I cannot be here tomorrow, so I know.
So, well, who else can't be here? Because we can reschedule rec to present to the board. I'm just going to go too far out.
I don't think I can, actually.
Yeah.
How about you?
I have transportation issues.
First senior only. That doesn't make sense.
I can do
teen.
Teen
and senior.
It's up to you.
Well, they haven't even presented to the board, so this is before going to the budget committee. I mean, they're the only group that hasn't presented to the board, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. I'll send you guys an email tomorrow, and we'll tell you when we're having our budget workshops and see if any of those days meet with you. And then you can come
But they can also do a board meeting. You can do a...
Oh, we can do either board, yeah, that's true. It can be, is Mondays like off the plate for, is Mondays a bad day for everyone?
No, about day.
Okay, okay. So let me, well, contact your schedules and send me an email about some Mondays that you're available in the next 2 to 3 weeks. And then you can present to the board, and then you'll, I don't know when you're on the schedule for the budget committee, do you guys know?
They don't start until the third week in October, which is not starting with rec, so I don't know.
Okay, all right.
I will tell you, October 28th, the school board is doing a sixth grade parent night about possibly moving the kids.
That's way late. We gotta come in before that, I would assume. That's a month away, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That's a Monday night, about moving sixth graders to Marshall Middle School. And if we are doing a Monday night, I need as much notice as possible.
I need to consider. So I have, my son has to go to bed, it's Monday at 5, but I might be...
But we might have my husband's.
See what the two of them can do, and you can come all together, or you can come and just do senior team.
And the 7th is fine.
So the 30th is good.
30th of September?
Yeah.
Okay. Is that a board meeting, or is that a workshop meeting? You know, I think it's a...
I'm not sure that it's...
I think it's a workshop meeting.
I don't think that it's either, actually.
I think we have them all scheduled up for...
Yeah, that's your...
The 7th. October 7th.
I could do the 23rd if that would be next Monday.
Yeah, I could do that one too.
Okay, that's a board meeting.
So I can do the 23rd.
You want to do the 23rd?
I might be rolling in right at the hour, I have, but...
The 23rd, which is...
Next week?
They all can do, and that's a board meeting, not a budget workshop, so want to put them on the agenda for that? Right at 6:30, or do you want to go for 7?
I would rather go first.
Right?
What?
No, because that's the vet visit, so I'm coming in, so 7 would be better for me.
Okay, let's put them on for 7.
Okay.
Yeah.
You may have to wait a few minutes depending on where we are, but they won't put you right afterwards if we go by you. Okay?
Okay.
So the 23rd work for you?
Yeah.
Okay, great. 23rd for them then.
I'll just go to Central Land up there.
Okay.
The one change Kelly pointed out to me on the team is I did not take the $50 from one line and put it in another. I just put $50 in the first aid line because we're ahead by $300 on team camp.
So team camp, we're breaking even, where it's fine.
I added in $50 for the first aid CPR training like you suggested last night.
Well, it's not the training, it's for the carts.
Right.
Because now they charge for the carts, which the fire department picked up that fee. I believe is what Mark said, right? So
then
it's not, it's the Red Cross that charges for it, not any of...
But still, it's okay to call it training.
Yeah, that's fine. So you can leave it there, but that was the, it was not, they're not going to charge you anymore. They're going to charge you, they'll continue to do it.
So that was the only change to team.
Okay, that's fine.
And we're still ahead.
Whatever.
No, that's fine.
Sounds like drive a van.
All right, so the 23rd, if you guys will come and present to the board. Okay.
Okay, so what is a reasonable time frame before, how about a next meeting for this group to get together and exchange job descriptions, or otherwise move on trying to plan for, and that doesn't have to be next week. Mm-hmm. It's like, I'm talking, you know, like, what's a reasonable time frame?
We set a meeting last night for October 15th.
Okay.
But that's for our committee. Is that, I mean, I guess that's pretty much all of us here except for Lori.
Is Kathy all done?
Well, she's going to be, I don't think she sold her house yet, but I don't know. I mean, that's why I'm saying we have dwindled down to this and Lori. So
maybe I'll put something on my Facebook page.
I got a response today that people are interested. They're talking at the school to some of the staff there that they're interested in rec, and they wanted to know if the videos were available online. So I referred them to YouTube, where I know they put on the videos, but I don't know. And somebody else asked if they could come videotape, and I said that was a question.
Well, we should start getting them on Facebook and just and advertising.
I keep on having Raleigh popping up on my Facebook like every day, advertising.
Really?
little robot-y guy keeps on popping
really?
Up. Yes. I was like, how do you stop it?
I don't know.
I've been getting it.
That's hysterical.
Yeah.
I've never had that before.
You know, it's like it's advertising Camp Raleigh.
Oh.
All
right. So let me
we need to
other people.
You're supposed to be promoted. And I was like, no, I just want you gone.
So
oh, that's Facebook doing that to you.
Because I've been in it.
But why? Well, that's another one question. But anybody can.
I said that they're open to the public and anybody's willing. Anybody can come in.
So anybody that's asking, did you say you want to be on the committee? Because we need more people.
You know, we did do flyers last year. I can refresh those and we can get those out in the hands of people.
Mm-hmm. For volunteers?
Yep.
I think those should
go. I think
we
need to.
Those should go to the school.
If we need, drastically need help.
Yeah.
You know.
Okay. All right, we'll do.
Or did we come up with an answer to you for a date? Is it the
15th?
Well, is that a separate? Should we do that separately?
Are you talking
from,
about starting the process?
I just want to keep you all on track with making sure that we have a documented program by. We need to pick a date sometime early next year, so that we have, like, once we have this documented, we have time to like. Send it through Primex, make sure the board can approve whatever the board needs to approve about it.
So let's lay
if
out.
We have time to tweak it if necessary, you know?
Let's lay out on the 15th plan for that.
Okay.
I don't have a job description.
Yeah, you do.
Maybe that's what we should do. Maybe you should write mine and I'll write yours.
There you go. Do it that way.
I'm having a better idea. I'm like, what did I do this summer? I don't know. I drove a van.
Although
what else did I do?
But I could write yours.
You know what? That's it's funny, but you might have a better perspective about, you know what you were contacting the other people for because you know what they
that
did.
That could be interesting.
It might
have
be
your tick list, your task list.
Yeah, see.
So you could approach it that way. You write somebody else's job description. You know, like we can talk about this on the 15th, but like, you know, we could have just all the jobs on a piece of paper, and I'm willing to write the job description for grant writing because I think I have a handle over
just
that,
you
know.
And you just pull
the ones that I'm willing to write a job description for, and you write a job description because you think you know the job, even if it wasn't the job you did. And then everybody else is eventually going to read them anyway. So it's just about drafting.
So if we have ideas now, we should jot them down.
Yes, that is a good point.
So if you want to get ahead of yourself for the 15th, even better.
Absolutely.
Like, there's things I can pull for you.
I love it. But if you all have notes about, you know, things that happened this past summer that were not so awesome, document that stuff as much as you can, like do like a journal entry and write it all down so that we make sure we
from HR,
put it,
by the way.
Okay, good to know.
My HR hat is off, I think.
So that we can, you know, make sure that whatever those kerfuffles were are not repeated next year, but they get like assigned to a job description or something. Or written out in the process, or whatever it is.
I was writing down what
you just
Caroline
wrote.
I was going to say, write down the steps or mistakes to
Kelly HR mistake.
So that they can become part of a job description or a policy.
To help.
Okay, your job description.
Well done.
And
clearly my choice is not so bad.
You did a great job.
Something like that.
Descriptions out there on the drive, too, that we used
for
last year.
For job descriptions? For who?
For like
all of them, like the counselor and the directors, they're all,
they're
those
on
are
drive,
on
right?
the drive, and they are worthy of review as well. But they're good templates, too, for yourselves, hiring manager, and what does that mean?
Sounds good.